10 feet with weed. Feels like a, oh boy. It feels like what we've been looking for right here. Look at this.
Whoa.
He's even trying to pull drag. Oh, that's a nice fish, isn't it? Wow, look at him. Look, we've got that bucktail too. Look around here. You wouldn't guess it, but it's like mid-November. What am I gonna do? I'm gonna chase smallmouth. The Great Lakes, Erie, St. Clair, Pickwick, maybe, but not this week. This week it's Cotter Country one more time. Maybe the last time, but I'm gonna pick a presentation, a little hair jig that you see me catch walleyes with, but I'm gonna go out and chase smallmouth with medium heavy action, 6'3", 6 foot rods, 6'6"s, because I'm gonna be fishing in areas where there's high potential for line breakage, heavy thick weed, zebra mussels and rocks and things like that. But I'm gonna go out and hopefully find, I don't think I'm gonna find a mother load. I think I'm gonna find sporadic fish, one here, one there. If I get the mother load, fantastic. This time of year, you never know what you can find when you go out, but that's the key, still getting out. If it's safe, you get a warm spell like this, go out there, have fun, catch some fish, like hopefully I will, very soon. Let's do it now. How long do I wait before I rip or snap that jig off the bottom? On some days, you lift up, the fish is already there. But today so far, I've been fortunate where I've been throwing out and I'm about 8 feet to about 11. And I'd say that last 2 feet off the bottom, where they're cruising at the bottom of this milfoil and cabbage and rocks and things like that, but they're at that bottom 2 feet. So I'm fortunate to feel that real slight little dunk where they're picking it up and they're eating it. So I'm throwing it out, I'm fishing a little bit quicker. If I find that it slows down, I'll throw out, leave a longer pause on the bottom so they can come over to it, look at it, pick it up. Because what that does is it shows me when they're really aggressive and they're swimming, and they're hitting it on the fall, that's an aggressive bite, even by walleyes. When you lift up sometimes and early on off the bottom, that means they're coming over, investigating, looking. So just use that as a gauge in a way of how the bite transpires from either really aggressive to slower, to maybe aggressive again. Watch how those fish bite. If you lift up and you got them, that's one thing. Feel the tick, it's another thing. But if you feel the tick and it stops for a while, slow down the bottom, camp it out, let it sit, then rip it up, let it sit again. Give them a chance to find it and eat it. First thing in the morning, you got the cloud like that, a little bit of haze. And thank goodness, no rain or snow. You gotta find them. Are they on the edge? Thick stuff. Where were they feeding? Guess I found them. Look at that, hey. Oh, nice smallmouth too. Oh, look at him. Wow. You see what I mean? Oh, that's exactly it. Look at him. November bass. We're gonna pull and drag. I'd say that's a pretty good fish to start our day. Exactly. The way I like to start it in November with nice, big, fat smallmouth. Look, we took it, hey? Just in the top of the app there. Oh, he's barely hooked. I've got something bigger, but look at that. Isn't that a nice way to start? Big, fat-headed bass. So let's put him in the live well. We're gonna let them all go like we always do, right, folks? Let's put them in there. That's a nice way to start, I'd say. Turn that on. Keep them nice and healthy. Water temperature is about 47 degrees, 48, and it's cold, but they still want to eat. That's the best part of fall, like I said. If you find them, that's the key, find them. Because once you do, you're gonna catch them if you use the right presentations and right baits. In this case, hair jig by thick weeds near the main lake, a little bit of a taper. Let's keep going and hopefully put a few more in the boat like that and show you how it's all done so you can go out and you can get them in November when you get a little bit of a mild spell. Let's go. I'm gonna look for little shoals, offshore humps, things that maybe some weed or some pebble rock and boulders and stuff close to the main lake basin, okay? I'm on a pretty popular cottage lake and they're all very similar. They've got rock this time of year. Everybody knows a smallmouth gang up in the fall, where they'd be really deep on shoals, surrounded by ultra deep water, or up as high as 5-6 feet, long as there's a couple things, cover and food. Now, maybe because of the water temperature and things like that, that the bait fish go a bit shallower. A couple degrees makes a big difference to a fish, and in turn, those fish go up and feed. So I'm gonna throw a bait. It's gonna have a reaction strike, a little hair jig. How I'm gonna work that is throw it out and rip it, snap it, look for a reaction bite. So I'm gonna move around a little bit, look for a couple spots, hit some waypoints, and hopefully find some real good ones. I'm gonna circle around a bit, look at my sonar, and watch till I see the weed edge. Right now I'm at about 13, 14 feet. I'm gonna fish probably as high as maybe 6 feet today, depending if the sun comes out, if it gets bright, where those fish move, where the bait moves. So just alter your approach, but I said, first in the morning, I wanna come on those outer edges. The sun's not out, a little cloudy and hazy, you know, and you got a warm spell for November, which is fantastic. And you just know those fish gotta be feeding. So, you're closer to the weed, take your time, don't have to rush. Let's see what's sitting on those edges. So far we know one little tank was there.
See what I mean? Told ya.
That's what I mean. Look at them fight too. They think it's July, look. They think it's July. Too fat to even jump, eh? Yep. You're not the biggest fish that we're gonna catch today, but you know what? It's another fish, and that's what it's all about. When you're in November, and you get a mild spell like this. Look, we got that. You just feel that boom. You know, I really believe that when you feel those bites like that, wow, that's the beauty about ripping hair in November. Put them in there. I don't want to spook any fish that might be in this shoal. Let's put them in the box. But it goes to show you that when they are schooling, there's two things that I think why they're grabbing that, you know, real aggressively, or the hooks are in there pretty good. There's numbers of fish with them, or they're just simply on the feed bag, like I said this morning, that they want to just eat. They see something. You saw the loons cruising around here. They're eating those perch about that big. My jig's about that big. They're going around. They're just moving, constantly going. You know, I don't think they're a real big pack because I probably get more fish in the same areas that I'm pitching. But I'm having to work around, go around, put some waypoints, find where they are on edges and stuff. But so far, no rhyme, no reason. First fish on the deeper edge, second fish in thick, about 8 feet of water. So keep moving, see if there's some more big ones like the first one. Now coming up this morning, I've got a preconceived notion of what I'm gonna use. The bucktail, or maybe a grub, or a tube jig. But 99.9% of the time, I'm vertically going down in those weeds, on the edge of the rocks, on the shoal, vertically. So I can cover the whole water column. Throw out, goes down, I'm in 3 feet, that's fine. But at 8 to 10, 11, seems to be where those bigger fish are. So throwing it out, watching it go down, ripping it up, down and up. If it slows down, I'll throw the grub maybe with some fluorocarbon. But you know what? The bucktail, I'm looking for a reaction strike. They see that, it's got that black silhouette, a little bit of chartreuse yellow, looks like a perch. It's got a few strands of tinsel. It just radiates in the water. When they see it, all they want to do is eat. This kind of fishing, it's the best of both worlds, but it can be just painstaking. You got your grip on your rod, you're just going ripping, snap, through the weeds. And you know what? Sometimes you just say to yourself, maybe they moved. Maybe they went somewhere else. You know what? They have moved, but just maybe thicker in the weed, on the edge, the slope. When you're fishing weeds on a ridge or a hump or a shoal, there's so many different contrasting things the fish can relate to. So you just gotta keep going. Put your head down, put out the jig, rip down, rip, knowing that if you just keep doing it, you know what's catching. You know you got the right setup. Rod, reel, line, weight, everything. It's all there. You just gotta keep going because all of a sudden you lift and there's a fish. So it's more of the hunt than the actual catch. Oh boy. Get ready, hombre. It's gonna be hook set time. Told ya.
Oh, another black piggy. Look at this. Wow.
Look at him in the water.
Come over here. Yeah, I know.
You acting all tough. Look at him. Pulling in the weeds, huh? Look at little piggy.
Thank goodness for that basket net. Look how good it holds him, eh? Did you just stay there? Someone's all calm. Let me reach in. Let me get him. Look how fat he is. Look how we got it again. Look at that. He's got that right in the side there. Just a real small, almost. I wasn't paying attention. I'd missed a bite. That's four. We'll put him in a box real quick with his buddies. Get to see some of those bigger cousins. We have to call you out soon, boys. Put him in there.
Moving around. I'm making real short casts, okay? 25, 30 feet ahead of the boat. Not much. I'm dissecting it. But what I found is, when I work these kind of weed beds like this and shoal edges and stuff, when it's overcast like this, they're on those edges. And it's imperative. The weed line doesn't run straight like a highway. It zigzags in, out, goes like a horseshoe, figure eight. You gotta just, you know, envision how it's going, look at your sonar, and follow those areas. Don't just, you know, haphazardly cast anywhere. If they're in those weeds, that's great. But I found so far, the bigger guys are on those sloping edges from 6 to 9, 7 to 10, etc., with more sporadic weed. Look at that stuff. While you're catching them, you'll catch more and bigger ones if you pay attention.
The biggest thing is fishing with confidence like this time of year. You might find, you know, a shoal or a bar or a hump or something that's just loaded with fish. That's fantastic. But most times, you gotta concentrate, take your time, one here, one there. But if you're still catching them this time of year, most guys have their boats already stored away. And they're not wearing gloves or anything. It's a perfect day for that. You just gotta have your mindset that you're gonna have to work a bit harder, do a lot of pitches. But the best thing is, you're not always starting a boat, pick up the trolling motor, go in other spots. You're dissecting a spot that you know fish are there. Loons come in and feed, and you're in those spots. If you keep at it, you're gonna catch them. Be more persistent. Be a bit more stubborn than they are. If they wanna take their time and bite, no problem. When they do bite, you get them. You just gotta keep at it. Big rocks in the weed. You couldn't find a better spot than that. So now angle and go on the outer edge. I'm just giving that bucktail time to fall. It's going through that water column. They're gonna tell me exactly where they are. Right on the bottom, 3 feet down, or cruising right below the surface, chasing bait. Let them tell me. What those light spots are is either sand or gravel, and it's transition areas, but you know what? Mostly they can just relate to it. Just something different, the minnows go to it. If a little bit of sun comes out and heats it up, maybe 2 degrees, that's all it is. Maybe even 1 degree. How do I know? I'm not a fish. All I do know is you find spots surrounded by weed, in thick weed, gold mine. Ready?
Told ya. Look. Wow, hey. Look how tough. Holy cow. There you go. Another boat. Oh, he's under there. Come here, are you. What's he caught in the weed? Gravel? Oh man, he's on a lot of weed here. Look at this. Look at him. Look how they fight that stuff, huh? Look at him. Come here, you. Oh my goodness, look at this. He swung at it and missed it. And look where I got him. Isn't that nuts? Look at that. Just a chunk sitting in there. I saw a small little gravel bed and about 3 good ones. Some were bigger than that. But he came over to it all of a sudden, thunk, and let him go. But boy, oh boy, oh boy. You see what I mean? This has been, seriously, a grind.
but a fun grind. This is the stuff they're sitting in right here. Now that fish and those other fish that are sitting in there, that gravel, exactly what I meant. You find the heavy weed, but it's a little pea gravel and the small little rocks and stuff that they're sitting in. When they're aggressive, they see this go down, wham, they eat it. I had to put that there. I saw two fish move. He came over, looked at it like this, and I felt tick. He hit the line, and I got him on the side like you do a walleye. So, of course, we let him go right away. But that fish showed me the mood they're in, that it's got to stay on the bottom. So here's something you got to do after you catch fish. I don't care if you're using braid or whatever it is. Check it. Now, I could get away probably with 30 and 40-pound braid or whatever, even 50 if I want to in this stuff, because they're aggressively feeding. But I still feel that the thinner the braid I can get away with, that I can still pull these fish out with that ripping motion or the snapping of the jig is imperative. They hardly see it. I bet they don't even see it. I don't think they really care. But the fact is, it's in my mindset that I don't want them to see it. I could go to a fluorocarbon, but I'm just taking a bit more of a chance because they could pull through that weed. These fish are pretty good size. But I'm always checking my points. They're sticky. I'll put a file to it if I have to. I check the knot, make sure it's in the right spot, and about a foot and a half. Why that is, a lot of times pike and stuff like that will come, they'll miss the jig, they'll just slash at it. If they nick your line, you don't know, or you don't check, next hook set on those bigger fish will be gone. Pay attention to your stuff, you're gonna catch more and bigger fish. Now as far as working the bait, underhand pitches, I'd say about 30 feet. I let it settle anywhere from 3 feet to about 11, and snap it. And I keep my hand on the reel, just in case there's a fish there, I can reel in real quick. I get a bite on the way down. And I'm watching the braid go down. It's laying down on the water, fall down, and snap it up. Go down, snap it up. What you want to do is, if you're in windy conditions, always watch, make sure the braid doesn't come on your tip of your rod, okay? We got really slick conditions this morning, so I'm pretty lucky that way. I can fish any way I want, in the wind, against the wind, the side of it, doesn't matter. I can dissect that little shoal or a little rock pile, whatever I want to fish. But I'm fishing fairly close because I want to keep my eye on the sonar and look where those weeds zigzag, not necessarily straight, they're zigzagging. So I want to find those fish that are hopefully on those outer edges because of the lack of the sun and more cloud cover. But the number one thing is paying attention. Watching that braid go down. Watch as that jig goes down. See if there's any signaling bites or ticks. Sometimes that little jig gets in the weed and drops. And just that alone, that little reaction, can cause a strike.
Yeah, 10 feet with weed. Feels like a, oh boy. It feels like what we've been looking for right here. Look at this, whoa. Even trying to pull drag. Oh, that's a nice fish, isn't it? Wow, look at him. Look, we've got that bucktail too. That's what I'm talking about. In November, in inland lakes, you can catch piggies like this. And I know I love fishing Erie, Simcoe, St. Clair, all those places that got pigs. Sometimes, weather permitting, you can go out, you can get them. Look where he's got it. Look at that bucktail. That is perfect placement of that hook. That's why I use that braid and that heavy weed, because you get those heavy bass. Look at him. That's a pretty big fish, no matter where you fish. I don't care if it's Pickwick, Lake Erie, or Simcoe. But we're gonna put them in the box, take some pictures of them, let them go. But I'm telling you, when you can get them like this, and a reaction strike with the bucktail, it's just you, the rod, the line, and the big fish. Let's put him in there. Look at that, he's got some serious girth. That's a big bass. Gonna keep going, play around, get on the edges, inside, wherever they want to fit, wherever they want to feed, that's where I'm going. Trial and error, yes. A lot of effort, yes. But the rewards, like that. Now when I'm feeling a bite, as you can see, I don't play around. I don't reel in that slack. Most times it's just a small little bow in the line where that jig's going down through the weed, close to the rock. I set, I keep the rod bent, and I reel as the rod's bent, okay? Because that little sharp hook, yes, I'm getting them pretty good, but if it's just in the skin and stuff, and they shake those heads,
and you drop that rod, those fish are gone. Just like walleye fishing, largemouth, all the stuff you see in Xtreme Angler. I make sure that when I set, the bend stays in that rod. If I want to set again, I'll lean again, make sure it's in there, and pick up that slack while the rod's bent. You're going to catch way more fish. Now look at this. Here's my day. It's like almost 2:30. There's all the weed. It's 47 degrees, 11 feet, tapering off the edge of it. But just take a peek at, look at all the little waypoints where I got fish, seen fish. That's my track. It shows me where I am, where I was, where I popped fish. So it gives you a reference of where to go, back and forth, and find it. I got it set at 100 feet. When I click it all the way in to 50 feet, it's a lot tighter. You can see I'm at the edge now, this little shoal. And there's the waypoints. I'll make mental notes too of what I saw, which ones and stuff. Give me a better idea to go back and maybe catch another fish. We're almost done. See if we can get one more. Now, as far as my tackle, you know what? I got the 6'3 Legend Xtreme. Medium action. I got that drag real tight, but that can pull when the fish hits. So when a fish hits and I set hook, it's not that impact on the knot or maybe pulling out a little skin or a little spot that just maybe just barely got him and stuff. You know, if I'm lucky enough that the fish inhale it and it gets into the meat, that's fantastic. But a little bit of drag, they're not going to pull that much this time of year. You know, the water's pretty cold, we're in the 40s, but they're still going to give a good count of themselves. So keep it fairly taut. If they're big, you can back off, let them run by the boat. Most times, tighten it right up. You want to make sure that that hook point finds its mark when you lift and snap it out of the weeds. Once in a while, if you've got a lake that's got pike in it, and musky as well, take the time. Check your point. Check your braid. Keep going. This is deadly right here. 9 feet, extra thick, but sparse holes between them. See? Oh, God! Missed them. Just said, you see that? When I'm ripping like that, that's probably the first fish I lost all day, and it is, too. But I'm paying attention, okay? And I'm seeing on the sonar, there's more holes between the weeds. It's not real thick weed. There's little holes and stuff. That could be rock, it could be boulders or little shoal edges and stuff, you know, pea gravel, whatever it is. But the bigger fish are coming from that stuff so they can see the jig and just it's a reaction. That's all I'm doing is ripping, snapping it so they can see it. And the real thick stuff, it's gonna have to fall pretty close to them for them to turn and look at it. And the open sparse stuff, you know, it's a double-edged sword. I wanna be close to the heavier weed, but in that sparse stuff that when they're cruising, they see something ripping, over they come, look at it. So I'm talking about here, see that? That's all real thick weed right there. And there's more holes, sparse stuff. That just changed. But see that? That little hole right there, that's what I'm talking about. Whenever my jig falls on that kind of stuff, there's a fish around, it's a good chance you're gonna eat it. There might be rock, sand, or gravel, whatever it is. That's the holes I'm talking about right there.
Feels like a good one. No. He's just a fat one. And look what it is too. Look what else is living inside this weed bed, eh? Mr. Bucket. Is this gonna be my last bucket of the year in Ontario? Yes, it is. My last largemouth of the year. Look what he's even got in his mouth. Look how they inhale that jig. See those weeds down there? They inhale everything that comes in. I think it's a minnow. Well, you're about the size of what I caught to start the year in Ontario. Let you go. And that's how you get them in the fall. Hair jigs in late November. Scary, fat, big. Like Great Lakes smallmouth. Gonzo.